Alex Cooper was a 65-year-old man living in Cranbrook, British Columbia. He had a wife named Margaret, and they have been married since 1952. Alex had 5 children and 7 grandchildren. He was a much-loved husband and family man. Alex enjoyed nothing more than spending time with his family and making music. From 1974 to 1986, Alex worked in the cleaning industry. In 1986, he took a job as a salesman. He had to spend some of his time on the road and would often be away from his family for days on end. On the morning of April 4, 1987, Alex's daughter Lila and her husband Pete left Cranbrook to go on a shopping trip. After they drove past the bridge, they spotted Alex's car off the side of the road. They decided to stop their car next to his and talk to him. The two of them walked down to the riverbank because they assumed that Alex was busy fishing. When they got to the river, however, there was no sign of him. Lila was concerned because Alex had a heart condition. She called her mom Margaret, who informed her that she had not seen Alex in over 24 hours. They called several hospitals, but he had not checked into any of them. The family then called the police to report Alex missing. Investigators found that his car was locked. Inside was clothing and fishing equipment. An extensive air and land search then began, but no trace of Alex was found. Investigators then decided to try and find out where was Alex last seen. They found that he had lunch at a restaurant less than a mile from where his car was found. Margaret told investigators that Alex always paid with a large roll of cash. She believed that someone saw all of the money he was carrying around and robbed him and took his life. Lila, on the other hand, believed that Alex went down to the river, had a heart attack, fell in and drowned. Newspapers and television broadcasts picked up Alex's story. This led to witnesses coming forward. They had seen a man matching Alex's description, hitchhiking in the area his car was found. This made investigators believe that Alex wanted to disappear. His family did not believe that is the case, as he was a devoted family man. It would also not make a lot of sense for him to leave his heart medication and credit cards at home. A year after Alex was last seen, Margaret started to look for Alex's birth certificate. She discovered that there was no certificate issued in his name. She could also find no record of Alex Cooper prior to their marriage in 1952. This left the Cooper family in a constant state of uncertainty. Then on May 27, 1991, another shock came to the family. Halfway across the country, in Toronto, another man went missing. This man was also a traveling salesman. His name was David Cooper. David had been living in a boarding house for approximately a year. He sold meat products to families over the phone. During one of his business trips, a friend of his reported him missing. When investigators looked inside his room, they found a photo of him holding his grandchild. Investigators believed that David Cooper looked a lot like Alex Cooper. They showed a photo to Alex's family, and they were able to confirm that Alex and David was the same man. On May 29, 1991, Alex went to his room after his business trip. He noticed that someone was there while he was away. He called his landlady and she told him that she had to open for investigators. When the police went back to the room a few days later, Alex was already gone. Investigators and Alex's family believed that something must have happened in his past which made him have to disappear. On September 25th, 1991, Alex's case was featured on Unsolved Mysteries. A viewer from Hamilton, Canada recognized Alex and called the police. Investigators located Alex in Hamilton. He told them that his real name was Albin Arsenault. In 1948, when he was 26 years old, he worked at the Union Pacific Railroad. He was accused of stealing. Alex did not want to be arrested for a crime he did not commit. So he changed his name to Alex Cooper, and 4 years later, he married Margaret. When he turned 65, he realized that he would not be able to get a pension, as he did not have the necessary documents. He could not bring himself to tell his family that he had been lying to them all those years, and he decided to disappear. Winston Bright lived in New York, had children, and a wife, Leslie. He worked for Verizon for 20 years. On October 12, 1990, Winston called his wife from work around lunchtime. All seemed to be fine with Winston, but he never arrived home. Leslie looked for her husband for years until she eventually gave up hope that he was still alive. Then 2 decades later, a man arrived at Leslie's door by the name of Kwame Seku, who claimed he was Winston Bright. Leslie did not believe him, however. Kwame went to court to have himself recognized as Winston Bright, but the case was thrown out since he had no way to prove it. It was only in 2018 when Kwame could prove that he was indeed Winston, when he gave DNA samples that matched his mother's and children's DNA. Kwame claims that he was stricken with amnesia, and the first thing he remembers is wandering the streets of San Diego with no idea who he was. He says he adopted his current name of Kwame Seku when he read it in a newspaper. He would only remember fragments of his previous life. In 2008, he started working as a teacher. He found out about his missing persons case online and realized that he was the man in question. He was on a trip to New York when he recognized a former acquaintance from a Jehovah's Witness group he belonged to. That acquaintance had notified his former wife. Leslie Bright said that she now believes Kwame is in fact Winston Bright, but said she did not believe his amnesia claim. She feels that Winston just abandoned them and started a new life.